Okay, we are live. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Stigma Free Zone. I am your host and tour guide, Brian King, and today I have the exquisite pleasure of bringing to you Abigail Sinclaire. Now, anybody who watches my feed on a regular basis is going to know that I've bragged on her from time to time, because Abigail is the one that brings me all of these awesome guests that I interview on this show. And I've been trying to get her on for a while, but you know how busy she probably is, because I'm not the only one she's providing this service to. But before we get in with Abigail, I want to remind everybody, especially if this is your first time, what this show is about. It's all about removing stigma from your life. Now, stigma isn't just what you think about in terms of the outsiders, the ostracized classes and whatnot. Stigma refers to that internal criticism, that internal sense of shame that we inflict upon ourselves because we see ourselves as being different, unworthy somehow. And it's just as important to eliminate that outside of ourselves in terms of cultural viewpoints as it is to eliminate it in terms of our own identity. And Abigail has this fantastic story that just kind of came up in conversation. I didn't even know this about her. And let's be transparent. Abigail, you didn't think there was much in that story either before we started talking about it. So before we get into that, brag on yourself a little bit and let everybody who's watching know what it is that you do.
Sure. Thank you so much. First of all, just thank you for even having me here and giving this opportunity to share, you know, what I do and my story. And hopefully, you know, by the end of this, it can help other people maybe come forward with their own stories and draw strength from that. So thank you very much. As Brian has said here that my name is Abigail Sinclaire, and I started a company just this past year called the Human Network Connection. And basically my goal or my mission with this was to help business owners and media outlets connect together so that they can be paired up with quality interviewees and guest experts to have on their shows, which in turn helps the business owner grow their exposure and brand awareness. So every Monday I deliver out a Gazette, and inside the Gazette, you will see media outlets looking for interviews, and you will also see a list of business owners, that are seeking to gain exposure. So it kind of has something for everybody. And also if you ever find either of them just interesting and just want to co-collaborate, they're also great for reaching out that way too. I've started building a community, and I'm hoping to get that launched here in the next week. And that way they have a more direct way of communicating with each other, scheduling the interviews and making a more seamless process.
Yeah. And like I mentioned, Abigail has done a phenomenal job of bringing people to me that seem like such a wonderful fit and have been, as you've seen, if you've been watching the shows, and she just has a real knack for that. And so maybe even you can open up a little side gig that's about matchmaking and helping singles find their dream boats and stuff.
there's
always an option, but let's stay focused. We're going to stay in our lane, right? Stay focused on this first. So let's jump into your story. And it begins by saying that your entry into the world was not according to what people typically envision for, you know, because you see in the newsfeed all the time, women showing their bellies and saying, hey, guess, is it a boy or a girl? And things started out for you a little differently, didn't they?
They sure did. My birth mother, her name is Delina, and she had no idea she was even pregnant. No idea. One day she was standing, I guess, in the kitchen, and she was getting ready to have breakfast, and her mother, which is the one who actually ended up raising me, she kind of was eating, and all of a sudden her water broke and there's just this mess on the floor. And her mom goes, oh my goodness, are you pregnant? Like, they just had absolutely no idea. Now it sounds very lighthearted, but the actual reason she didn't know that she was pregnant is because she was a drug addict. And I'm not really sure what kind of drugs that she liked to enjoy, but I just know that that was part of that situation, and also what led to me being born at only 4.5 months, which is pretty intense. I spent basically pretty much a year in an incubator trying to catch up and grow and develop muscle and being poked and prodded to stimulate the muscle tissue to develop and grow. So lighthearted intro, but that's kind of that. So she had no idea. So they're rushing her to the hospital. This is a Navy base that we were stationed at down here in San Diego. And we get there and the doctors explain at this point that just simply 4.5 months of, you know, being inside is not enough time to grow, that odds are I will probably not make it. And that anyone who wants to be here should probably say their goodbyes now at this point. Kind of a sad introduction, but from there.
Yeah, so from the beginning, everybody was believing in you.
Right. Yep. It is true. So everyone's just, you know, hoping like that would come through, that I would be okay. And when I did come out, I actually had a valve in my heart that wasn't fully operational. It just hadn't finished developing. And what was happening is blood flow was coming back into it and essentially drowning me. And I couldn't function. So I had to have open heart surgery right there, right as soon as I popped out. And I'm, you know, obviously I have no recollection of this, but I'm pretty sure it was pretty traumatic. And from there, they put me into a baby ward and they had me in an incubator and, you know, tubes and everything tucked up into me. And one of the only photos we have of me as a baby is me inside this incubator and one of those 5x7 congratulation cards, you know, you have a baby, and I'm actually smaller than the card itself, weighing under 1 pound and, you know, just trying to fight for my life and make sure that, you know, that I'm going to be here. And so that's kind of that first beginning part. Once they had me in the incubator for a while, I'm not exactly sure how this next part happened, but somehow there was a flesh-eating bacterial kind of virus that came through the baby ward, and somehow me and all the other babies were infected. And as the story goes, it was only me and I think maybe one or two other babies that actually survived. And I like
how
to think
babies
that
babies were in there.
I'm not sure. My parents, they didn't say how many. So I don't know that information.
Yeah, and they probably did you a favor by leaving that out.
Yeah, probably.
No baby needs to start the world with survivor's guilt.
Yeah, right. It's, you know, it's, what do they say? It is what it is. You know, it's a powerful entrance into the world. I mean, already, even those other babies that did survive, I mean, they themselves have had the odds stack against them too from day one. So, I mean, you know, for some reason, we're all here. And, you know, I don't know what happened with their lives, but, you know, I really hope that we've all made our lives become something and mean something, you know, at least to ourselves, if nothing else.
That is definitely one of the pluses of coming through a situation where you know darn well others didn't make it when you did. Mm-hmm. And it's, you can be guilty or you can turn it into purpose. And right. That's one thing you and I have in common. You know, I had cancer when I was 18 and I have a lot of other chronic issues. And I saw people my age that didn't make it, young parents that didn't make it. And I felt guilty for a while, like I wasn't good enough. But then I said, man, there's not a whole lot I can do with that point of view. Mm-hmm. Let's kick it up a notch and kick some butt instead.
Yes.
And one thing that I noticed about you, because I watched you on social media before we connected, because you and I are in a Facebook group together. And one thing I noticed you doing is you would try something because you wanted to be an entrepreneur. You would try something, it wouldn't work, so you'd try something else.
Mm-hmm.
So I know from the beginning that you were no quitter.
Right.
So that was something that was awesome right out of the gate. And now knowing this backstory, clearly your first foray into the world was fighting like hell, just to survive. And I don't know what anybody's, you know, beliefs are, but I think there's something in that. There's something that just gets burned into your DNA. When your body has to struggle like that, it can't help but impact your development as a human being, whether it's conscious or not. You know, I just sense that that's within you. Do you see it that way or am I totally off base?
No, you're spot on. And I think that, like, not only does it happen on a subconscious level, because, I mean, we don't even know exactly how we really mentally develop at that age. You know, there's something going on, and I'm not a history on that. I don't really know a whole lot, but there's definitely something that in your first moments in this world, you decide. I could have easily given up and been like, "Whoo, can't do this, guys. Peace, I'm out." But there was something that happened. You know, thankfully also the doctors were there too, but I really think it takes both. You know, it takes the physical, you know, support of the doctors and nurses that help take care of me and make my body functional. But then it also has to take something on a spiritual and soul level to make sure that I'm pulling through for myself. I mean,
oh, absolutely. There've been some research. You look at some married couples, and not necessarily even elderly couples, where one spouse dies and the other one dies within close proximity, and they call it the broken heart syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Now, where something happens biologically where that person essentially loses the will to live and their body starts shutting down. They don't really know what the mechanism is for that, but there is enough of a precedent to see something's going on here.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you can't put your finger on it, you can observe it.
Definitely.
You know, and in your case, now your mother not knowing that she was pregnant to begin with, did she suddenly discover her maternal instinct and rally and be there?
No. So the plot thickens a little bit here. So my birth mother tried to take care of me. And, you know, addiction is a hard thing to deal with. And I don't know if it's really necessarily trying. I think, like, I'm just naturally a compassionate person. And I think I've been this way because of my experience into this world and everything I've had to deal with on a mental and emotional level from day one. So she could not properly take care of me. I don't really know the circumstances. Again, it was kind of information that my family just didn't share with me. And so I know that they did take me from her and helped raise me. I've actually never met my birth mom, never done it. And I know that a lot of people would hold, you know, maybe a lot of resentment towards that, anger, hostility, and maybe that would flare up in different aspects of their own lives. But I feel like, you know, ever since I was little, I always felt like I understood. And I understood how hard it would be for her. You know, first of all, she has to deal with this addiction problem. And then to have a baby who needs serious medical support and care in the first few months is just so much. And I could understand that if I were in her shoes, the best thing I would also do is probably give that child to people who could raise and support that being to the best of their ability. So, you know, if I ever met her, I wouldn't be mad at her. Totally understand. So
that is a beautiful perspective that you have discovered there. Not only did you extend some compassion towards her for what she was going through, but you in turn saw what she did for you as a compassionate act.
Mm-hmm.
So even without meeting her, you've already kind of arrived at this, we loved each other enough to part ways.
Mm-hmm.
And that is such a beautifully healing way of looking at it. And I hope the people that are watching really take that in. Because one thing I've learned over the years, there's this wonderful saying that one of the best things you can receive in life when you've been hurt is the apology you were never given.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's part of what allows you to forgive and let go. And you've right. never met her, and yet there was still that very loving parting of ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I figured, you know, I'd probably never get that answer. I'd never get that apology. But it's so interesting because this wasn't something I discovered in my teens or in my adult later years, 30s, whatever. This is something like I've always had in my mind as long as I can remember. And it was never something that the family who raised me put into my head, because it's quite interesting. I had a conversation with them a couple years ago, and they actually think that I resent her and that I have all this hatred towards her. And it's like, it's very strange that they would think that, even though my entire life I've never ever once expressed that. So, you know, it makes me wonder if they maybe have a little bit of projecting here going on, but
quite,
you know,
a bit,
just
I'd
as
say.
Long, yeah, but just as long as I can possibly remember. I remember when I was little, you know, telling classmates about my situation, you know, gym class, they'd see the scar on my stomach and they'd wonder what's going on. And so I'd kind of give them a little spiel about it. And even then, I remember, you know, second grade, first grade, I mean, just always explaining that, like, it was for the best. Sometimes you have to do hard things for the greater good. So, you know, I'm grateful. You know, I imagine my life maybe would not be where it is today if I had stayed with her and had grown up in that situation. I do know that she's gotten clean. She has a family. She's gotten married. So, I mean, it's beautiful that she got to clean up her life and do the stuff she needed to do as well. So I think overall it's best for everybody, you know.
That's wonderful that you at least know that about her.
Mm-hmm,
that
yeah.
She's gotten clean and created a life for herself. Now, it's interesting what you mentioned about your relatives thinking that you probably resent her. That is a real good mirror on potentially how they view themselves in those yeah. circumstances.
Yes.
One thing that I hear from people when they hear about what I'm going through is they say, oh, I could never do that. Like, well, guess what? I didn't have to do it either until I was in it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you find out that you have to develop that strength. You have to get the resources. And then suddenly, hey, I guess I can do it. But at the moment when it's not required of you, you don't see yourself in that position. So from early on, there was some internal or cosmic wisdom that you somehow connected with that equipped you with what you needed. Now, from the conversation we had where I learned this about you, I got the sense that even though your parents wanted, I mean, your grandparents who wanted better for you, so they took you from your mom, it was kind of a bumpy upbringing in their hands as well, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm, definitely, yeah. Yeah. You know, they'd already raised 6 kids. And I imagine they thought they were just about done. You know, they were going to be able to go kind of start their lives and do all the things you wish you could do when you're done with children, right? And I was kind of a little hurricane in that. So, you know, I think there's a lot of things that maybe were never discussed or said or, you know, put out there about that whole situation. And as grateful as I am for the upbringing, you know, they definitely kind of helped harden me a little bit, you know, and not in a bad way, I don't think. They helped me understand people more because I had to, again, put myself in their shoes and their minds and figure out where they were coming from with their emotions that maybe they weren't verbally telling me. So I think really it's just made me understand people all that much better and understand hardships of others without having to deal with those hardships directly inside my own person.
What kind of feedback did you receive in terms of what they thought of you and your potential? Were they PTA parents? Were they showing up to cheer you on? And how did that work?
It's a little sad. So anytime I wanted to be involved in anything, sports, acting, singing, instruments, they weren't really that supportive. I came home one day really excited about being in this play in high school. And I was like, you know, I just got a little tiny piece, but it was something to do, something different and something, you know, I could experiment with. And my mom or my grandmother had told me, you know, why are you even in that? You don't sing, you can't dance, you don't act. Like, why are you even trying this? And so it was kind of that type of feedback that I got a lot. I wanted to join the soccer team and it was kind of the same dialogue. Why? You've never done this. Why bother? And so funny enough, after I got out of high school, I started playing soccer recreationally all the time. So I've never allowed what other people have thought I am capable of or not capable of kind of affect me. And this includes even the doctors. You know, because of my rough entrance into the world, I was supposed to be physically handicapped, mentally handicapped, and not have a great quality of life. And I think I've definitely managed to achieve quite the opposite of that. I'm more than capable in very many facets of my life. And, you know, I would love to kind of sit down with those doctors now and chat with them and see, you know, what else I could get
out
of them.
Are you kidding me? Track them down and show up someday.
Right. I do have all my medical records. I should. I mean, I'm in San Diego now, so.
Yeah, you'll probably find a lot of them on the golf course somewhere. It's just a matter of which one, right?
Yeah, there is a golf course right over there. I bet I can go find them right now.
I wouldn't be surprised. Just go out there with a bunch of photos. Anybody that looks like this, but older and decrepit,
Right.
You guys I'm looking for. Probably in really bad shape. Yeah, that's the one.
Right.
And you have so many gifts. I mean, other than the fact that you are just a survivor, you're a gifted artist.
Thank you.
Right? You make logos and all kinds of really neat things for people. Mm-hmm. You are a passionate and gifted connector of people. What else are the things that you found that you are just really good at?
So this might sound a little strange, but I call it the gift of knowing. I am one of those people that I'm just gifted in the ability to do anything, literally anything. And it doesn't ever take me much time to pick it up, to try it, to figure it out. I just kind of do it. I have a painting in my bedroom. It was my first painting I ever did of a palm tree and some water and a starry sky. And when I tell people that was my first painting ever, it blows their mind. They're like, what? This is just like, you just have a natural ability to do this. But that goes to everything that I do. I never went to college to get a degree in like graphic design or anything. I just happened to pick it up and be good at it. And that just, like I said, just translates through my entire, everything that I do. And I'm so lucky and blessed to have that ability. So
would you do my taxes?
You know, I actually used to work for a tax office and know lots about that. So I potentially could. Oh,
wow. How serendipitous. We can definitely talk off the air about that. I can absolutely use that. Because my math skills are completely in the toilet.
Yeah.
So what is next for you then? We know about the project of matchmaking between podcasters, in this case, videocasters, and mm-hmm. ideal guests, but what else do you aspire to?
Yeah, so I think we've discussed this a few times. I'm in the middle of actually getting a cognitive behavioral therapy practitioner certification. That was a mouthful, my goodness. And my dream for that, and really my dream overall for life, is to develop this business that I've referred to as the Nerdy Mentor Girl. And what I'm establishing with it is I'm creating a series of comic-themed workbooks that focus on the CBT methods and tactics of improving your inner working, your mind, your actions, how they connect together, and how that improves your overall quality of life. Because of, my story and everything that I've been through, it was so interesting that I used all of these CBT tactics before I even knew what CBT was. Like, I started learning about it and I thought to myself, I do almost all of this and I had never heard of it. So I just felt like just a natural calling towards it. And, it's something I've been practicing my entire life. So why not share that with people? Why not help them, maybe reach emotional and spiritual and mental levels that they never thought they were necessarily capable of because of self-hindering,
Well, you did you took ownership of your thinking very early on, mm-hmm. and CBT is rooted in that, yes. that you own your thoughts, you can change your thoughts, you can bring in thoughts that are much more empowering to you as opposed to disempowering, and that's Correct. Just a big part of who you are. And one thing I'm looking forward to people seeing is that adorable little nerdy girl graphic that you drew up.
Yes.
It's like you as a superhero, right?
Yes. I'm going to make some alterations to it, but I am like, I love it. I love that you are your own superhero. Everything you need is fundamentally right in here. It's in here. It's in here. And all you got to do is learn how to connect it with the outside world. And that right there is just going to be phenomenal for people that I hope I can help.
And you so embody that. I mean, there are so many people out there these days, and you've seen them, that took a course, and now all of a sudden, they're the next enlightened guru.
Right.
And they're going to come out, and they're going to save the masses. And then there are folks like you that have eaten the very dirt that you are now going to help coach people through finding the other side of it.
Mm-hmm.
So how close would you say you are to launching that?
My goal is to be launching it in December and January, get that up and going.
Right around the corner, but in San Diego, you won't know it when the season changes because you're just out there in the warm weather.
Every day.
I will have to come out there for the launch party and maybe even overstay my welcome so I can miss the Illinois winter entirely.
That's a brilliant idea. Everyone should miss winter everywhere. come to San Diego. It's beautiful.
Yeah. If I want to hear about blizzards on TV, I'm not like those crazy weather people that want to be in the midst of it. No.
Right.
So one thing I absolutely insist that you do mm-hmm. is go on Facebook. You're going to see the wonderful little discussion thread. Drop your links in there so everybody who's watching can find you.
Wonderful.
Because okay. there's a lot of business folks who could absolutely benefit from what it is you're doing. And if for no other reason than to just follow her and watch her in awe of all the awesome stuff she's doing. So for those that are just listening, tell us out loud, what's the best link people can follow to keep tabs on you?
Sure. I would say, honestly, probably my Facebook page for the Human Network Connection. So just be www.facebook.com/Human Network Connection. Or /Human Network Connection. But I will be dropping several links. Right now I'm offering free 30 days of advertising your business or your media outlet in my Gazette. I'll provide a link to that. I'm also offering a 30-day discounted price for my membership program too.
I took advantage of that. It's absolutely worth it.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. And honestly, the value of that membership is just going to keep growing. So I am super excited about this.
Well, Abigail Sinclaire, is not only a pleasure to be in business with you, I'm honored to be your friend.
And thank you so much, Brian.
I am grateful that you came on today. Everybody, please send her a big cyber hug.
Yay, hugs.
And share this interview with people so that they can see just what a rockin' human being Abigail is. Thank you again for being on. I'm so glad we finally made this happen, coordinated our schedules.
Yes.
We'll be talking again soon.
Definitely. That sounds great. Thank you for having me. And let's definitely get something else on the calendar and chat some more. So thank you so much.
Absolute my honor. Take care, everybody. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure you share frequently and often, and we'll see you next time.